一点点，左右这边你修边，但是在我们西方，what distinguishes them? And this is where Sterling tried to make the distinction. The first distinction he made was in the controversy as to what is it that distinguishes this art, classical art of Hong Kong from the 9th century, from the earlier art, pre-art, is conservatoire Parisier has written two big books on this art, the mere primitive. And Stern is trying to find out where did this transition from pre-art to art take place. And Stern made only one trip to art, and the sixth with his student then, Pierre Dupont, went to Newfoundland, and there he found that missing link and argued that it is in Newfoundland, transition from early 9th century, pre-9th century to 10th century, we call classic time. So, it's called land. And so here, this is a classic pre-Angkor Vishnu. This one to an end. And Dr. James Kuhn there will be the authority to tell us and find it whether this is so. Half is in right. And further on, all these are Vishnus. How do you think that? How do you distinguish? I want a round big face, a high head dress, but everything is usually Vishnu. But you are an art historian, so which is the later, which is the earlier? How do you tell? And so, this is where Stern and his students and fellow art historian then turned their attention to the details of the subform, how the subform is folded. Give you a clue to their table. Crown. The star. Notice here, the legs are absolutely big and fat, whereas here they are much slimmer. Are these all tricks that tells you something about how to group statues in a sequence? So this is where the nation comes. I mean, this statue is quite clearly down. Head and top, the walls and back, the great backpacks must be a very lit, degenerate form of a very high one. This one is responsible for the right. Let us see how the art form goes. And so, Pierre Dupont was Stern's student. He unfortunately died rather early. He started his work looking at the upper one, the Varati, and you read his pieces here, it's very painful, the almost detailed analysis of what all the finds there, the styles, the motives. Dupont did another big book on pre-Victorian art, in which the current stylistic definitions, six of them, one of them is entirely due to his work there. Come back to that later. Another of Stern's colleagues, Julie Quincy, she did all her work on looking at Indian connections and Indian art, applying the same method here. So Quincy had argued with the other one around together with Stern, that much of the sources of Angkor can be traced back to very specific sites and periods in Indian art history, specifically Ajanta Caves and Amagurati and Ellora. And I think you have Ajanta Cave, you got down to very specific cave numbers where motifs were copied from. But I think it was the art historian John Boissier who probably did the most to extend Stern's method. Where Stern absolutely disregarded epigraphy, disregarded history, and just looked at the sequence. Boissier said, you've got to bring in some history somewhere. And so Boissier had a long career dating from 1955, where he did a thesis on the statute of Angkor that more or less established art styles that we are about to look at Kun, whom Charles Hoffman is Kun, was also a French train and extended that method of Stern to the study of Thai art. So, to come back to Boissier, the dating of those Vishnu that you saw owes much to Boissier's work, where, for example, looking at these stuff of how we are ordered, and therefore the different poles represent different eras and periods of the of what they are ordered in a certain way, the bion is ordered in a certain way, and the pre-Kamiya in a way. I won't go into that right now. So, at the end of the day, what can we get? This is then the art style stamp. Stern, Boissier, and others have established where they try to link it with the various one acts. So, here the art of grapple style associated with Mahavan, Aswaran. Then the art shift to Angkor, Makeng, from where it goes to there, go up there to look at Angkor Wat. And then under Yavon 4, the capital was shifted to Poker, where you have a rather different, more massive style of building, noise, and then it's a return to the people style, playing style, and somewhere Pantisserie. Pantisserie is enormous simply because it's a wonderful little temple. But that style is not very prevalent. This is one of the very widespread. And this then becomes one of the major problems in Stern's method. Finally, and then the part one style, the very massive style of Stern's shape. Number one, and finally, the Sion. So, that's how the styles have been linked up to a sequence of Khmer kings and rulers here. Stern finally returned to the Bayon in 1965. He wrote another massive monument, a book, in which just on the Java Mutt monuments were able to distinguish classical early period of monuments, the middle period, and the late period of monuments here. And this method of Stern has, I think, become absolutely consolidated. You can't run away from it. It's the paradigm, the template, that the whole series of conservators of Angkor from George Bollier. It's a very nice little cartoon of him. Bollier was the first to use aerial photography to map Angkor, and here to see the camera. Supposedly married Angkor, and the big catalog of Angkor art, which is the one by Jason Lin and Alan Lizard, that has much popularized this style, this way of dating the monuments of Angkor according to their styles. And of course, in the art catalog, especially when we have Stins and Sotheby's and Christie's, all have views. This categories of style to take and authenticate their works that they are offering for sale. The problems with this method is that number one, it is divorced from epigraphy and other historical data. So you may get a sequence, but which is earlier, which is the later. And you must have somewhere to date. Then you can put another relation to that one motif that can be created. So this has always been a major problem with the Dumont's method. The other is that it assumes that there's one sequence line of kings, and you can associate monuments with them and the style with them. Now, one is, as we say, there's more than one center. So, if you take especially the pre-Angkor period, where where we now realize that there are various centers of power constantly each developing their own little different style of art. And there's a problem with this method of how do you put it all into a nice little string sequence there. And this is especially so with Montessori. This is a very distinctive group there. But where else? If we gave the Montessori to what it is, then it is possible that we found in other factors there. So, sample sizes, again here, how many do you need? How many works do you need to find a style? Move on, and keep on working on the three or four styles. I think it will be four or five statues on that particular Dada style. And for the others, like the great book again, doesn't that resolve? Is that sufficient to define a style? And what if you're too big? University is on record saying that all these motives have to be very carefully chosen because if there are too many, too common, just can't make sense of it. So what is the ideal sample size here? Very subjective question. Come down with that. And which motives again? Certain motives are so common, and others are so rare, it doesn't make sense. It's a very small sample size. So these are then the problems have with Stern's method, which however has become, as I said, the template. Now, let me in conclusion, let's see, so where do we go now? And I think we have to return to Willetts. Willetts was, from what I can gather, remember, was never following Stern in that way of painting monuments according to their character styles. He was, I think he had given his training in biology, he was looking at more function. So, if you remember the big book on Chinese art, he associated certain art forms with certain Chinese dynasties. Like, if I remember correctly, it was fraud with the Shang, silk with Han, black with something else, architecture with the song, ceramic with the harp. And within that, then, he traced how the molding functions of that object then led to changes in the forms, the shape, the decor of the object to reflect these changes in the use. And so, yeah, I think this is the way we may have to go to supplement what Stern was trying to do here. Also incorporate the functions. So, with the case of pre-art art today, as Dr. James was saying, we have in the last year been finding huge numbers of statues, little ones, not the big ones that looking at. So what sense do we make of these little visions? Far in the Mekong Delta, can we now say that you know, the function in terms of religious rituals, these were little ones were more home use, whereas the big one was for a state temple. And again here the different iconography as it reflects here the differences in the way of worship. I think it's a way that I think we have to look at